Hey, would you stand with us this morning? Let's praise God together. Yeah, put your hands together.
Our leaders hear about the vision and values of our church and just a little bit more about who we are. So you can sign up for that on the app or on the website. We'd love to have you there. Also, hopefully you received a card on your way in. If you didn't, grab one on your way out, because we've got some upcoming events that we want you to be aware of. One of those being our annual Unveiled Worship Conference in May. We've got an amazing speakers and worship leaders that we're excited to be here in the Springs. And then we also are hosting a VBS this summer. So why don't you greet the people around you, say good morning and happy Easter.
I could never in a million years think that I would be able to say that I'm not an alcoholic anymore. My name is Joel McClellan. I grew up in the church. It was a very Holy Spirit stifled church. You know, if you don't have that relationship with Jesus, it's almost like it's not real at that point. You have father and son, but that's just in paper, you know. There's no relationship, there's no feelings. So I ended up just going on my own path after high school, during high school, and just got deeper into partying, deeper into just doing whatever I wanted, because I had no purpose in my life. And I was lost, man. I was confused. I didn't know what I wanted to do after high school. So I just kept drinking, and I realized I could drink. And I could drink and drink and drink. And then after that, it was like I had to drink, or else I couldn't function. And that was a lot of my life. I never thought that I was not going to be an alcoholic. I had 100% made up in my mind that was the rest of my life. There was no hope. I mean, it just got to that point where I ran out of any resources I had. Slept in a tent by the railroad. Addiction is rough. Just so crazy, like, what those drugs will make you do. And, like, the spirits, I guess it's the spirits probably attached to them. Like, under the influence of meth, you will steal. You'll steal. And it doesn't even matter why. Satan was doing things to, like, scare me. I almost felt like he was trying to make me go crazy by the things he did. And, like, what made me realize that there must be a God was just seeing the evil out there. If this stuff's real, then there must be a God too. I started seeking him. I wasn't sure if it was Jesus at first, but that was like what was so important to me. Like, I was just seeking the truth with my whole heart. You know, it wasn't necessarily Jesus that my answer was. I didn't have an answer. The spring of 2020, I've been out there two winters. At this point, I'm really starting to believe in him. I see his miracles a lot more, and I see the spiritual world a lot more, and how he works in our favor and stuff, how he's protecting me, how I never had to worry about where I was gonna eat or how I was gonna have clothes. I always had plenty of stuff out there. He was always taking care of me to the point where I could give my stuff away to people that needed it. I was just having one of those days that God was talking to me a lot, and I ended up in front of the Salvation Army. He just told me to start praying there, and that's like when I got baptized in the Holy Spirit right there. Looking back at it, I'm like, wow, I was asking for help. And that's what God says. If you ask, he'll send you the helper, you know. I got up and started praising, man, and I was crying, and I ran across like America the Beautiful Park, like proclaiming his name. And like everybody looked at me like I was crazy. But since then, I knew that I was his, and I was, you know, what that meant. That's really the day that I understood what that meant. At first, after that day, like, not a whole lot changed. I thought, like, miraculously everything was gonna change. But the girl I was with at the time, she was pregnant with my son. I was still kinda in some bad stuff, but I was on the right track. But I had gotten in a little bit of trouble, and I was in jail when he was born. While I was in my stint in jail, that helped me get off the alcohol. I quit smoking cigarettes and stuff in there. And I knew the responsibility that I had when I got out. And just, God made that really clear to me. And plus, he had always put it in my heart to want to be a dad. So I was just really excited. I know it sounds cliche, but I look back and I don't see that person in me anymore. Like, I was so angry and so upset all the time and like so depressed. I just thought that was normal, man. I thought that people felt like this and I just couldn't handle it. I'm a totally different person. I can't even explain it really. The deepest, darkest places that he's willing to go for us. Even when I kept saying no, 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 like he's like, no, I'm gonna keep trying. I'm gonna keep trying because you're mine, you know? Like, he wasn't giving up on me. Stop thinking about your sin and start thinking about God's love. I'm a sinner, but I'm saved and redeemed, you know? I could never in a million years think that I would be able to say that I'm not an alcoholic anymore. But Jesus broke those chains, man.
Woo! Yeah. So how many of you believe in the resurrection? How many of you believe that because Jesus rose from the grave, you can rise from the grave? So I was just getting ready to get up. A bunch of young guys came up to me over here to tell me of something that happened yesterday. So yesterday, this group of guys and gals were coming back from a trip. They came into Loaf and Jug, and there was a guy laying on the ground dead. And he had taken some fentanyl, and someone was pumping on his chest, and he was not responding. And they went over, and in the name of Jesus, they spoke the word of God over this young man. They cast out his demons. And he was raised up, and he's with us today. So, Josh, would you stand up, Josh? There's Josh right there. Come on. Come on. I want all you guys that were part of it, would you guys stand up? Yeah. Awesome. Love it. He's alive. So the resurrection of Jesus Christ is the greatest news in the world. Our whole life, we don't even know how much our life is changed by the resurrection of Jesus Christ. So if we even look at our dating system, this is 2024. What's that based on? That's based on Anno Domini, the year of our Lord. Jesus' birth, we wouldn't know anything about if he hadn't risen from the grave. He'd just be some crucifixion that occurred in Roman times who claimed to be a savior, but he died and he rose again. His resurrection has affected our entire dating system. Now, some of you here have Bibles with you. Hold up your Bible if you have a Bible with you. All right, we wouldn't have this Bible. The Old Testament, which was written before Christ, is a prophecy of a Messiah that was going to come. And the fact that Jesus died on the cross and rose again gave us the New Testament. So the entire Bible comes because of the resurrection of Jesus Christ. We look at our Western civilization, the arts, the science, and all aspects that we just take for granted every day is because of the resurrection of Jesus Christ. The Pilgrims and the Puritans came to found America, a new nation based on equality, a nation based on freedom of religion and freedom of speech, was because of the resurrection of Jesus Christ. And so, men and women, this is the greatest day of the year. Easter, the resurrection, is the greatest day of the year. And you're here. And I just want to say high five to all of you for being here. Because this is the greatest day of the year. And sometimes we take it for granted in America. They don't take it for granted in China. They don't take it for granted in parts of Muslim strongholds in Asia and in the Middle East. I mean, they're being persecuted for their faith. May we never, ever take it for granted that Jesus rose again from the grave. And we can walk in that and we can experience that and we have freedom right now to worship the Lord. And so I'm just so thankful all of you are here. I'm Steve Holt. For you that have never been here before, I'm the senior pastor, and we welcome you. We have baptisms today. I didn't even know this. We just did this because I like doing it when I was at my other church, and I do it here sometimes. I don't do it every year. But actually, historically, the tradition is to get baptized at Easter. And I've been studying St. Patrick and the Celts in Ireland and some books that I'm reading right now, and I just realized that in ancient times, in the first probably 5 centuries, of the church, you always got baptized on Easter. So we're following with tradition, which is really cool. Isn't that fun? All right. If you have a Bible with you, turn to 1 Corinthians. It's in the New Testament, chapter 15. If you don't have a Bible, there's one in the slot, maybe in front of you. But knowing that on any given week, people don't have Bibles, that's fine. We're going to put the verses up on the screen. So I would challenge you that have Bibles, and if you're one of those like the road people are, that like have pens and you take notes and everything, these verses I'm going to give you, I hope, will be inspirational as you look back at 1 Corinthians 15, because this is the greatest passage in all of the Old or New Testament on the resurrection of Christ. It's key to everything. You couldn't go wrong by memorizing the entire chapter. Now, I'm not going to go through all of it because the time won't allow, but I'm going to skip around and we're going to talk about why the resurrection is so important. So look at verse 1. Start with verse 1. It's really important. It says, "Moreover, brethren, I declare to you the gospel." You ought to underline or circle the gospel, "which I preached to you, which also you received, and in which you stand, and by which you are saved." Now, gospel, how many remember, how many are old enough here to remember the Broadway hit Godspell? Okay, Godspell. So gospel, Godspell, means good news. And in the midst of fake news, false news, and fearful news, we have great news. It's the gospel of Jesus Christ. It's good news, and this is what makes it really good, is that it's true. Anybody gotten the idea that sometimes the news you get isn't true? Okay, and sometimes what you think is true is actually called a conspiracy theory, and then they find out a year later, you were right, they were wrong, but they never admit it. But that's okay. We have good news because Jesus rose from the grave. And it's better than any news. No matter how good the news might be, there's no better news than the good news of what he's about to say. So here's what he says. "For I delivered to you, first of all. So this is the first thing that we need to know about the good news of the kingdom of God. "Of all that which I received..." This is the first thing. This is the main thing. This is the foundation of everything. "That Christ died for our sins according to the scriptures, that he was buried, that he rose again on the third day according to the scriptures." So the best news concerning Jesus Christ are these three points. The first one was Jesus died for your sins. You say, "Well, I'm not a sinner. I'm not a robber. I've never killed anybody. I've never robbed a bank." That's the way we view sin today. But sin simply means, in its term, in the Hebrew or the Greek, is missing the mark. It's the idea of missing perfection. And if anybody here raises their hand, if I ask you, "Are you perfect?" then I'm assuming you're not married. Okay? So we're not, nobody here is perfect. And so we're all sinners. We all struggle with sin. Another way to say it is we're selfish. We're selfish people. We all are. I'm as selfish as anyone. And I'm trying to grow into that and out of that and expose it so that I can grow into being a better person. Well, Christ died for your sins, past, present, and future. Not just your sins now, not just the things you've done, but he actually died on the cross knowing your future sins, that if you receive him, he forgives you. Now, if you haven't received Christ, then you're still in your sin. But this is the good news. You can, even today, Easter 2024, Resurrection Day 2024, you can be set free from your sin and completely forgiven. So that's the first thing he says. Number two, he says he was buried. Now, the Romans were not only good at building roads, they were also good at killing people. And so they were probably the best killers of all time. As a matter of fact, you did not survive a crucifixion. When you were crucified, they waited until you died, and they knew when you were dead. And if you weren't dead, they deadened you. They either broke your legs or they hit you with a spear. Jesus was actually pierced on the side, and they saw blood and water come out, and they knew that he had had a broken heart. So he was dead. The third thing that Paul says here is that he was resurrected. So he says here that he died for our sins, he was buried, and then on the third day, he rose again from the grave. Now, that's the good news. That's the gospel. So if someone said to you, "What do you mean, what do you Christians mean by the gospel?" That's it. Jesus died on the cross for our sins. He was dead and was buried and was put into a Jewish tomb. And on the third day, he rose again from the grave. That's the greatest news the world has ever known. Now, Paul, anticipating when he wrote 1 Corinthians to the Corinthians, those who were in Corinth where Christianity had really not penetrated yet, he gives an apologetic next for how we know Jesus really died from the grave. I mean, he's using modern courtroom evidence. Verse 5. He was seen by Cephas, then by the 12. After that, he was seen by over 500 brethren at once, of whom the greater part even remained to the present. In other words, he's giving us the classified information, if there was a courtroom trial about the resurrection of Christ, that over 500 people, eyewitnesses, saw him alive. And that, it's one thing to make that statement and you're in some faraway place, but he says, actually, those people who saw Jesus risen from the grave are still alive today. They can verify that they saw him alive. Dr. Thomas Arnold, professor of modern history at Oxford, said, "I've been used for many years to study the histories of other times and to examine and weigh the evidence of those who have written about them, and I know of no one fact in the history of mankind which is proved by better and fuller evidence of every sort to the understanding of a fair inquirer than the great sign which God has given us that Christ died and rose again from the dead." Dr. Simon Greenleaf, while professor of law at Harvard, wrote a volume examining the legal value of the apostles, that's the 12 disciples, testimony to the resurrection of Christ. Greenleaf concluded with this: "The resurrection of Jesus is one of the best supported events in history, according to the laws of legal evidence administered in courts of justice." So why? Because this is really the most important thing today for us. Why is the resurrection of Jesus Christ the greatest news that the world has ever known? Well, 1 Corinthians 15 gives us four clear reasons. There's probably eight, but I'm going to camp on four distinct reasons in 1 Corinthians 15 as to why the resurrection is so important in our faith. Why it's the foundation of Christianity. Why it can change your life. Here's what it says. Look at verse 20. So jump down to verse 20. "But now Christ is risen from the dead and has become the first fruits," underline, circle, whatever you like to do, first fruits, and put number one right next to it. "First fruits of those who have fallen asleep. For since by man came death," by man, notice that's a capital M, man, that means the second Adam, Jesus, "also came the resurrection of the dead. For as in Adam all die, even so in Christ all shall be made alive." Here's my first point. Jesus' resurrection is the first fruits of your resurrection. It's the first fruits of your resurrection. Well, Steve, what's first fruits mean? Well, when I grew up on a ranch in South Carolina, we had first fruits. And so that meant that the garden that Granddaddy had, which was about the size of the sanctuary, when those turnips were ready, or those cucumbers were ready, or those tomatoes were getting ready, usually around June, believe it or not, June, okay, that's the South, you'd get a little tomato, or you'd get a little turnip, or you'd get some collard greens, or something like that, and we had hands that would go out, and they would gather them into this basket that grandmother had, and bring them in, and here we were in the kitchen, hanging out, first fruits. In other words, first fruits means it's an indication of what's to come. It's an indication of what's to come. So by seeing that first tomato, by seeing that first turnip green, that was an indication that there's going to be a harvest. There's a harvest coming. That comes from Leviticus 23. So in the Old Testament, Leviticus 23, which we call the Passover, which we're going to celebrate here, a Jewish Christian Passover that we do called the Seder that we're going to do on the 22nd of this month. You'll hear when Haim leads us in that, he'll talk about the Passover related to the first fruits, okay? So the first fruits is that Jesus died, rose again as a indication of the harvest in your life and in my life. We're going to rise from the grave because Jesus did. In other words, when Jesus conquered sin and death, He set us free to conquer sin and death if you're a believer in Jesus. So it's pretty cool. The first fruits. So in Colorado, you don't see first fruits for a while. So we have summer, fall, winter, and then it's summer, right? But in most places of the world, you actually have a spring. And in the spring is your first fruits. And so you're going to see first fruits. It's just a little bit later, but you'll start to see that little sprig, you know, on your lilac. So you'll see that little sprig on your aspen trees or whatever it is you have. Or if you have flowers, you're going to have that first flower. That's first fruits. That's important. The resurrection of Christ is a first fruit that you are going to rise from the grave. And guess what? When you rise from the grave, you're going to have a perfect body. Now, some of us in this room, I'm included, work pretty hard to try to have a perfect body. I exercise and I take my vitamins and I walk. I do stuff like that. And some of you do that too. If you're part of the road, you do it a lot because we're the healthiest church in Colorado Springs. We are the healthiest church in Colorado Springs. And some of you are doing Whole Hard 45 right now, which if you don't know what that is, ask your neighbor. They'll tell you. But not now. Wait till later. But anyway, you do that because you want a perfect body. So say to your neighbor, I want a perfect body. Well, you ain't going to get one. But there's good news and bad news. The bad news, you ain't going to get a perfect body here. But guess what? There's a day coming when you'll be diseaseless. Okay? You will be heart pressure, blood pressure free, and you're going to have a perfect body. This is the first fruits. You're going to get a perfect body. Work hard at it now, but you are going to get one. I want to encourage you in that. Look at verse 24. Then comes the end, when he delivers the kingdom to God the Father, when he puts an end to all rule and all authority and power. That's important. He's going to rule over all authority and power. For he must reign, underline reign, until he has put all enemies under his feet. Number two, Jesus' resurrection is just the start of his reign over all authorities, powers, and enemies. So if Jesus hadn't risen from the dead, we have no power over demons. We have no power over Satan, and we have no power over death. But because Jesus rose from the grave, he went to hell. In that 3 days, if you ever ask yourself, what did Jesus do in those 3 days? Well, we know in Scripture that he went into hell, and I don't know exactly what the transaction is, but we have these cryptic verses in the New Testament that would indicate he preached the good news. He preached the gospel to Satan, demons, and the dead. And we have this real cryptic story where in one of the gospel accounts where right after Jesus died, people rose from the grave. Talk about first fruits. So they rose from the grave. And they came in and they actually showed themselves in Jerusalem that they had risen from the grave because Jesus went down. He went down where there was paradise and there was Hades. And you see this in the story of Lazarus and the rich man. And he preached the gospel. And I think what he did is he came up to Satan and he said, I'll take the keys. Give me the keys of sin and death. You had them for a while. You ain't got them now. I'm not dead. I'm coming back. See ya. Okay, now that's more of a southern way of saying it. But that was the beginning of the defeat of Satan. So when I've had to cast out a demon, and I think these guys had to do the same yesterday, demons get really quiet when I walk in the room, especially when I call them out. And I say, in the name of Jesus, stop doing that. And they stop doing that because it's not because I have authority. I just have confidence in his authority. Every one of you in this room that is a Jesus follower have the same authority and you have the same power. And if you say, well, how do I get more of that? Meet more demons. You meet more demons, you'll get more power. Okay, and so demons are all around, but we get to set people free. So we had this young man when I was living in Japan who had epilepsy. That's how it was diagnosed by the industry called healthcare. He's got epilepsy. But after I cast out three demons out of him, he never had epilepsy again. Years later, he's never had epilepsy again. So that's the power that the resurrection of Jesus, by him going into hell and announcing the resurrection and the power of Jesus, that we have today. And so Joel, in giving his testimony, suddenly had power, Joel, over cocaine, over heroin, and over alcohol. You didn't believe it. You believed it, and you received it, and you're baptized with power. And God can conquer any obstacle in your life. I'm telling you, man. You can see his conquering power working through you. So Jesus' resurrection, first of all, is the fruits of our resurrection. Number two, Jesus' resurrection is just the start of his reign over all authorities, powers, and demons. Now look at verse 42. So also is the resurrection of the dead. The body is sown in corruption. It is raised in incorruption. It is sown in dishonor. It is raised in glory. It is sown in weakness. It is raised in power. Number three, Jesus' resurrection enables us to experience God's power. We can experience God's power because we've received his power because of the resurrection that he came forth from the grave in power. Now, the problem we all have is what he said. We struggle with our own corruption. We struggle with dishonor. We struggle with shame. Everyone in this room struggles with shame. We've all felt shame, and it's a bummer, man. It's like one of the worst things. It's a struggle. Some of you carry shame in a big, big way. It makes you insecure. It makes you angry. It makes you bitter. But I'm here to tell you from personal experience and from thousands of others that if you'll surrender your dishonor, if you'll surrender your shame, if you'll surrender your addictions to Christ, his power will come in. It may not be overnight. Now, sometimes it is. I think for Josh, you say, that's pretty overnight over there at the Loaf and Jug. And so sometimes it happens that way. But most of the time, it's a process, you guys, of knowing Jesus, growing in Jesus. And Josh is going to have to do that too. He's going to have to grow and be discipled in Jesus in his life. So Jesus' resurrection enables us to experience God's power in our life. So why is the resurrection the greatest news in the world? It's the first fruits of our own resurrection. It starts his reign over all enemies. And then fourthly, Jesus' resurrection makes you unshakable. The resurrection of Christ can take you, a shakable individual, and start making you inner within an unshakable person. We are all subject to the fear of death. Man, COVID really showed that to us, didn't it? How many of us were actually very fearful of death? God can make us unshakable by taking away our fear of death. Look at verse 54. So when this corruption has put on incorruption, and this mortal has put on immortality, then shall be brought to pass the saying that is written, death is swallowed up in victory. O death, where is your sting? O Hades, where is your victory? Now jump down to verse 58. Therefore, my beloved brethren, be steadfast, immovable, always abounding in the work of the Lord, knowing that your labor is not in vain. Men and women, you can become a person who has no fear of death. C.S. Lewis said that all that death is moving from the room that we're in right now, a door opens and we enter another room of eternal life. So we have nothing to fear. Now, if you don't know Jesus in a personal way, you have a lot to fear. But I want to challenge you today. That fear can be broken. That fear can be replaced with faith. You can become a flying creature. You can win your wings. To quote Clarence in It's a Wonderful Life, George Bailey's guardian angel. Here's what C.S. Lewis said. God became man to turn creatures into sons, not simply to produce better men of the old kind, but to produce a new kind of man, a new kind of woman. It's not like teaching a horse to jump better and better, but it's like turning a horse into a winged creature. In other words, what happens when we receive Christ is it's not a reformation of you, it's a transformation of you. It's not a reformation of the person you've always been, it's actually a revolution of a new man and a new woman that you can become in Christ. That's what Easter Sunday's about. That's what the resurrection is about. We're gonna go into worship right now. We have the Colorado Springs Tabernacle Choir. And we're gonna go into worship. I want you to focus, worship. But then we have baptismal pools. It's in the Jordan River, but it's the closest we can come to it. And we're gonna have people getting baptized. But I want to invite you, if you're in this room and you've either never been baptized or you'd like to receive Christ, what I've said to you, you know in your heart, God is speaking to you that you need a transformation in Christ. Come on up, clothes and all, we'll put you in the water and you'll be radically changed from this day forward. So when you see guys coming up, if you want to come up, come and get baptized with us, all right? And now here's what I need to say at the conclusion is the ministry team, people are gonna pray for those who get baptized. They're all gonna be over here, all right? And so you on the ministry team, we really needed you in the first service. We're gonna really need you in the second service. So if you could come up and pray for people when we go into baptisms. So let's stand and let's worship the Lord, amen? All right.
Show me how much your sacrifice. You didn't stay in the grave. You shed your blood so that we could be free, so we could be transformed from the inside out. But it's the power of the grave that brought you to a place, God, where you could offer eternal life to us. You conquered death and the grave.
Before my eyes, I see the heavens open. Swinging wide the doors into your throne room, with lamps of fire burning all around you. Seated on the throne, seated on the throne.
just give you the opportunity, if you'd like to receive Christ, become a Jesus disciple, Jesus follower today, you're invited up. And Josh, you get to be first, man. We're so glad to have you here. So come on up. And the ministry team, if we could have ministry team people gather over here. So they're going to get baptized one by one. It'll be one at a time, and we'll catch it. You'll be able to see it on the video, even though you're in the back. And then they will, when they come out of the water, they're going to go over here and get prayer. So let's just go for it and continue to worship.
Thank you, Jesus, for
Final breath, and it was finished. on, every voice. Oh, hail King
Jesus.
Oh, hail the Lord of heaven and earth. Oh, hail King Jesus. Oh, hail the Savior. Come on, sing it again.
I know you guys got some of it on the screen with the video and everything, but pretty cool being up here and seeing the tears and the new life being discovered and experienced. So thanks to all of you for being here today. When you leave, over to the left is our welcome center, and give us your name. And if you'd like to know more about the church, theroad.org, theroad.org, lots of stuff coming up. In 2 weeks, we have kind of our welcome luncheon. If you're looking for a church, it'd be good for you to come to that and hear the vision and values of our church. Now, I'd be remiss if I didn't close out by just saying, if you still want to get baptized and you've sort of been like wondering, should I? There was a lot of people that got baptized up here spontaneously. Pretty cool. So feel free. The guys will be up here for a few more minutes, and we would consider it a joy to pray with you and invite you into the kingdom and begin that new discovery and adventure with Christ. So God bless you guys. Have a great Resurrection Sunday. Thanks for coming, and may the Lord be with you.